Domain validation has always been a big deal in programming, and I don't mean things like string is null or white space. That's for kids, I mean real validation. But now, validation problem aside, we have a different problem at hand because the latest C# is already letting us design entire functional domain models. Now, how do we validate that? What do we do to validate a model which is entirely built on records? Do you see the problem? I have seen everything. People do gruesome things to records. So in this video, I want to show you that the situation is much simpler than you may think at first. So please join me in this demo. I will show you the web API with four endpoints. One is getting all the person objects from the database. Another is getting one person by ID. And then comes the interesting stuff. Creating a new person, that is where we will need some validation, and updating one person's property. Most of the complexity here is in the create and update endpoints, as one could expect. That will raise the question of validation. The model is just a record, it contains nothing. Then how bad can it be when I just instantiate it like I do here in the post action, which creates a new person? This web API must be a disaster waiting to happen. There's no validation at all. I can put any data in and it will end up in the database. But I still hold on to my old adage, if you have to defend, you have already lost. Defensive code is much simpler than most programmers think it is. Surely you must defend from external input. You may say this code is bad because you can create an instance and save it in the database without any validation, but I will tell you, no, you cannot, because this code is not everything there is. There are also tests, end-to-end tests, integration tests, which I will now run, and you will see 3 out of 6 tests, there are only 6 tests now, are failing. And let me read you which tests are failing. Create person with a null first name fails. Create person with empty first name fails. Update person with empty first name fails. That is precisely where the validation is missing. My pull request would be automatically rejected because it's failing the tests. That is the first revelation. You don't really have to plug every hole until you see the bigger picture of your code. You need to understand what are the requirements and what precisely needs to be protected from. That is where the story of validation begins, and I will do it this time my way. The domain model is at the center of validation. It should verify some attempts to create an instance, but let some others pass without validation. Now, that is the puzzle. Most importantly, the storage must have the right of passage. All objects passed validation before persistence, and the repository must recreate those objects from database in the exact same state. If you think how EFCore works, it does precisely that. It will look for the parameterless constructor, even if it's private, use that one to create an empty object, and then populate the fields, the private fields, directly. Have you thought of that? There's no validation when you populate an object from the database, only from external parts of the system. And database is not external, it's controlled by the application. Therefore, such a constructor should remain the one which doesn't validate anything, but nobody else but the infrastructure should be able to use it. The first step in adding validation to this entity is to introduce a validating factory function. Let's take another look at the using side. There are two ways to instantiate a model. Any entity could be a fresh one, like here, or recreated from a previous instance of that entity. The difference is in the ID of the entity. In the first case, when we create a fresh one, we don't have the ID. In the second one, we do have the ID. And so I usually define two factory functions. Their names should tell the distinction. Besides not having an ID in the first variant is called create new and the other one is called restore. Anyway, both variants would delegate to an all-encompassing factory function which is private and which will essentially do the validation and create the instance. I constantly hear two questions about this design. One is why not move these static factories into the record, and the other is why not use constructors. So let me answer that. Factory methods like this are not the only factory methods that will exist in the end. Why would some factory methods be in the record and others out? That doesn't make much sense. So the precise answer why not put these static factories into the record is that I don't see a sufficient motivation to do that. Now, why not constructors? The second question is more interesting. Because factory methods can do more than the constructor. A factory function can refuse to create an object. Constructor must always create an object. Also, the factory function can return a different type, like an interface type or a base type from which this record is derived. That is where the validation comes. We need to read the customer's requirements to decide what code comes here. For example, the simplest of all requirements would be to disallow null or white space strings. If that is the case, I will return the null person indicating that I refuse to instantiate such an object. Otherwise, I will just sanitize the input by trimming excess spaces and letting the last name be null or empty, but ensuring that it is not null after sanitizing it. Now we move to the web API, which caused those acceptance tests to fail, and fix it. Look, instead of using the constructor directly, I will use the create new method, and the compiler is immediately raising a warning because the result could be null in case that the input values were invalid. If that is so, I will return the bad request response and the compile time warning disappears because now I have effectively validated the input. Two more tests are passing now. I have plugged the holes in the creation endpoint. Only the update endpoint remains. What it does right now is to seek the person object in the database by ID and return not found if the repo returns null. But now there comes the part where I didn't validate the input. I will use the person restore this time, and the compiler is awake again, telling us that the check is missing. I will return bad request again. The compile time warning is gone. I'm running the tests again, and this time all the tests are green. So I did add validation to my model in a very straightforward way. I was protected by the acceptance end-to-end tests. This is the minimum you need to do to use an entity implemented as a record. The question remains, why is the constructor public? I still could, if I was very undisciplined, use the public constructor and break things. So the next step would be to hide that public constructor. Before I show you that last step, let me remind you that this channel and all the videos on the channel are free for everyone thanks to the patrons. And so, if you like what you have learned from this video and other videos on my channel, then please consider joining the growing community of patrons on my Patreon page. I'm very grateful to everyone who is helping me in this endeavor. Thank you. Now, let's see what we can do with this constructor. If you wanted to remove the scaffolded primary constructor from the record, you would need to implement your own read-only properties manually. That would also disable the with expressions. So once you cross this line, there are no more with expressions for you. And then define the plain constructor and make it internal so that you can pick which assembly can access this constructor. You will see that the infrastructure assembly has failed to compile now, and that is the only point where I'm using direct access to the constructor. There's a trivial solution to the problem. Go to the models project and expose internal members to the infrastructure. Now, if you are frowning upon what I'm doing here, you're not alone. I'm frowning upon it too. It's a part of a bigger story of encapsulation. You know, we love encapsulation more than mom and dad. But when it comes to implementing it, then it really doesn't work in all cases, so we cut a few corners. As I said, it is a part of a much bigger story. All I want to see here is the compile time error in the infrastructure assembly gone. So my entire application is compiling, all the tests are passing. If you get the source code from Patreon, you can start it. There is a Swagger page. You have access to all these endpoints. You can play with them. You will see that everything works perfectly. What I want to point out is this. This is how I have implemented the validation with the separation of concerns. There is the creation. There is the data part. I'm keeping those two separate. I'm still maintaining my entity implemented as a record, and everything is tight, and there is no way for you to create this entity in an invalid state. I hope you enjoyed it, and if you want one single thing to carry from this video, then it is the message that domain validation in functional models is very simple in the end.